Okay, hi Caroline.
Hi.
Would you like to tell us a bit about what you do and your job title?
Yeah, my name is Caroline Wild and I work for Northumberland Time and Weir Trust. My job title is a Deputy Director. I work for the Chief Exec and I look after the Communications Department and the Board and Corporate Affairs.
Okay, and how did you get into all of that? Did you go to uni to Grays and everything?
Yeah, I did. I went to university and when I left university I had a job as a graduate trainee at John Lewis. Which is an unusual route to get into
yes.
the NHS. But after I'd done that for about 2 years, I had my first daughter, Eleanor, and she's really complicated. She was born with lots of very severe disabilities.
Yeah.
So I didn't work for a long time after that and did a lot of voluntary work and working in the community and voluntary sector to try and help people have a voice in health services.
Yeah.
And then I came and worked in the NHS after that. So I've come into the NHS as somebody who's a patient and a carer, rather than someone who's come in as a manager.
Do you think that's really helpful for your job?
I do. I think it's brilliant for me. It's the thing that makes me make sure I do a really good job, because what I try and do is make sure that whatever I do is good enough for my family, and that's the standard I use for everybody else's family.
Mm-hmm. That's brilliant, that, because I feel like with my mum sort of being my carer when I was poorly, and she had a really tough time getting support herself. So it's brilliant to know that there's sort of staff in the trust who can understand that side of things and like how important it is for the service users' support outside of the trust.
I think being a carer is a really, it's a very difficult role, and you have to be really quite political in some ways when you're a carer, because you want to get the best for your person that you're caring for. But you can't be too demanding, and you can't be too grumpy, and you can't be too banging on the door, because you worry that that's going to have a negative effect. But you can still see things very clearly that need to change or that need to move on, so you have to be quite assertive.
Yeah.
And it can be really stressful to get that balance right.
Did you have any struggles sort of after you'd had your daughter with your own mental health and just the challenge that it brought, I guess?
I didn't straight away. I think when she was first born, it was quite a shock. And so it was, people talk about it being a bereavement, but it wasn't really. It was different from that. We had to get the baby that I thought I was going to have wasn't born. It was a different baby.
Yeah.
So it was just different. The time I got really, really stressed and distressed as a carer was actually a few years later when I had my third child, Lucy.
Okay. Lucy's, how many have you got?
I've got three. Just the three.
All girls?
No, I've got the boy in the middle.
Oh, okay.
Ben's nearly 19, he's at university. Lucy's 15 now. So it was 15, nearly 16 years ago that I found it really difficult. And what was happening was I had Eleanor, who was really demanding and required help all the time, every minute of every day. And then I had Ben, who at the time was a toddler and who was busy and wanted to watch Bob the Builder and, you know, make a mess and do the things that boys do. And then I was pregnant with Lucy, so I had this huge bump and I had to do a lot of lifting and handling of Eleanor.
Yeah.
And I was just exhausted all the time and everything seemed to be a fight. And we didn't have a wheelchair for her and we didn't have a bed for her and nobody was helping at all. And it just felt really overwhelming. So that was the time I went to my GP and I said, I'm just not coping very well.
You must have felt quite alone as well, if you felt like you didn't.
I didn't have. Yeah, I think I was in the house a lot.
Yeah.
You know, I was really, I couldn't get out the house very much. So all those things that you would normally do to make yourself feel better, even just going for a walk, was really quite hard.
Yeah.
So I think I'm kind of always seeing myself as somebody who copes. And when you're somebody who copes, and you put in a situation that you couldn't possibly cope with, you suddenly go, I don't know what to do now.
No, so and questioning yourself as well, and be thinking, I thought that was my strength, and now it's a challenge.
You do, and if you think, I can't even manage two children,
what's
going on? So I think when she was little, I was absolutely fine, but as she got older, it was much more stressful and difficult, and it gave me quite a lot of anxiety around, how am I going to manage when I've got another child, and how am I going to manage as Eleanor grows up, and how am I going to manage to be a mum and do all of the other things that I need to do.
So you mentioned you went to your GP, is that sort of your reaching out for help, is that how it's gone?
Yeah, I mean I have a brilliant GP who has just known us for the whole time Eleanor's been around, We don't actually see him very often, but he's always been brilliant. And I went in and I said, look, you know that I'm somebody who copes and I'm just not coping and I don't know what to do.
Yeah.
And he was brilliant because he said, you know what, I'm really pleased you've come and told me, because I didn't think you would ever get to the point where you felt you could talk about it.
Yeah.
I guess he'd been able to see that I've been a little bit stressed beforehand. So I remember really clearly in that appointment that what he didn't do, he didn't give me loads of advice and he didn't give me, I suppose what he did do was he told me his story about actually how he'd recently gone for counselling and recently gone for support from, it was kind of an IAP service, but it wasn't called that then, it was that kind of stress awareness class.
Okay.
He said that he'd recently been to one because he'd been having some problems, and he was equally the kind of person who thought they would never get any help from anywhere else, but he went to this class and he found it really helpful, and he said, would that be something that I'd be interested in? So I remember going into that appointment feeling really scared about talking about it, and really scared about what he would think of me if I'd said I hadn't coped. And I left thinking that it was okay to not cope sometimes. Yes. Sometimes
it's okay to ask for help.
Yeah, sometimes the world is just stressful and it's okay to ask for help, and nobody's going to judge you when you do that.
Yeah, that was a huge thing for me, you know, when things first started and I sort of, I didn't tell anybody what had happened to me, and I started to hear voices and I just went straight into overdose and was sectioned straight away, and it was sort of a huge shock to my family because they didn't realise things had been going on for me.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was so scared that people would judge me, one, for what had happened to me, and thinking like, oh, it's her fault, she's done this, she's done that, she's asked for it. And then two, because I was hearing voices, and I thought all of the things that I worried other people would think about me, I already thought them of myself.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like really reluctant to ask for help, but in the end, that being that reluctant put me in such a dangerous situation, which I think is like why I'd promote people asking for help. And you know, you've just talked about how it benefited you and things, and how have you, since you've had that difficulty in the counselling and things, how have you coped since then? Has that just given you the skills for the rest of your life, do you think?
I think it probably has. Yeah. I think what was really important for me was to accept that I couldn't fix everything.
Yeah.
Sometimes the world just works slowly, and that it's okay to not just ask for help, but to ask and ask and ask and demand help when you need it. And that was very much about the practical things. So Eleanor needed a chair.
Yeah.
So having that conversation with my GP meant that that happened a little bit more quickly, because he asked and I asked. And even though I'd been asking loads of times, the fact that he asked again, it moved things along.
Yeah.
So that was a really important thing, that actually just accepting that it wasn't me, that sometimes there was stuff that is wrong with the world that you can't fix and you can't wave a magic wand for. But I think what the stress control class helped me to do was identify when I was getting stressed and when I was getting more than stressed.
Okay.
And when I was getting anxious, rather than just thinking that was normal.
Mm-hmm.
So now I'm quite good most of the time at knowing that I'm starting to get worried, or that I'm starting to speak a bit faster, or that I'm starting to not finish jobs.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things I do when I'm starting to get anxious is I do everything myself. I stop giving jobs to other people.
Yeah.
I stop asking my husband to help me. I stop asking the kids to set the table. I just kind of think that I've got to do everything.
Mm-hmm.
So when I have a day when I think, oh, do you know, I've done everything today, I kind of have a little talk to myself and say, actually, this is something that you need to do differently. You need to just make the point of giving somebody else a job to do. That's the right thing to do.
Yeah. So because we're filming this to do with Time to Talk Day, which is all about stigma and discrimination of mental health, have you had any experience either yourself, or have you witnessed any that you could maybe talk about giving a film?
I think working in the job that I do, I try really hard to talk about stigma a lot.
Yeah.
Because I think talking about it is a really good way to get rid of it.
Yeah.
And one of the things I've discovered from working with mental health patients or people who use services or people who might have a mental health problem. And I try really hard to get people to talk about us, because it isn't them and us, it's us. And it's amazing how quick people are to separate themselves from a conversation about mental health. So I try really hard to talk about it and to talk about my experiences and to talk about the experiences we all have of feeling sad sometimes and feeling stressed sometimes and feeling anxious sometimes. And we all have that experience of mental health. So I think it's really important that we talk about that a bit more. And one of the things that makes a difference for me is talking about people, because we know that people struggle to get jobs and struggle to decide about their mental health needs when they get a job. And so talking to employers and giving them the tools to have a conversation with somebody is really, really important.
Yeah, definitely. And it's so important when you think about the 1 in 4 statistic, if 1 out of every 4 people are going to have a mental health problem. And you just think, if there's 8 people in a meeting, 2 of them could have mental health problems. And I feel like everybody's got mental health though as well, in the same way everybody's got physical health.
Yeah.
And it's just the people who might struggle through life and through something happening to them. So it's brilliant how you've been helping battle stigma for people. I think, finally, can you think of 1 reason why people should read I'm Not Disordered?
I think of lots of reasons why people should read I'm Not Disordered.
Okay.
When I read it, I always learn something new. It always gives me something to think about that's different from the way I've thought about it before.
Yeah.
And knowing you a little bit, I'm always inspired by how strong you've become. Even on the days when you're not having a good day and you write about that as well. But the strength that's there is amazing, and I think that helps me to deal with some of the things that I'm doing.
Thank you. And thank you for taking part for this.
You're very
making
welcome.
Some time for me. You're a busy day.
Absolutely fine.
Thank you. Right, this is what I do every time.
Cut!